I love you, Lord, for your mercy never fails me. All my days I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful, and all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God. You have led me through the fire, and in darkest night, you are close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. 'Cause all my life you have been faithful.
Oh, yes, you have.
And all my life you have been so, so good. Every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness of God.
Thank you. morning, family and friends. Today we gather to remember and honor the beautiful life's journey and the time we have spent with Beresford Barrington Simmons Jr. We also come together to celebrate the legacy of love, kindness, and joy that he has left behind. We honor Beresford for his inspiration and devotion to his family, his service to community, his compassion for those in need, his love of children, and his strength and courage to stand for what he believes and to speak for those who could not. Maya Angelou once said, I've learned that people will forget what you said. People will forget what you did. People will never forget how you made them feel. My brother Beres was one of those individuals who always made people feel loved and welcomed. He was always willing to step up to help those in need. He made everyone feel important and valued. I remember a time when I was learning to roller skate, and he and my sister Doreen had a grand plan of teaching me how. Now, if you've ever been to the family home a couple blocks away, you know that there is a slope in the driveway. Well, my siblings decided to push me right down that driveway and almost into oncoming traffic. Luckily, my brother was able to catch me in advance. Each of you comes today with your own unique memories of Beresford, for he was not the same person to any two people. Let us embrace those beautiful memories, the shared laughter, and the countless moments of joy that marked Beresford's journey on this earth. As I look out to everyone here today and online, I see so many people Beres has loved. And I realize that even in death, he is with us. On behalf of my family, I would like to say thank you so very much to all of you who have come to be with us today to join us in saying this final farewell to Beresford, a loving son, father, brother, and uncle. I would like to call upon Suhaila Simmons to read a poem of remembrance titled Remember Me by Margaret Mead. Thank you.
Good morning. I didn't realize so many people were behind me. I'm Beresford Simmons' sister, and obviously he's a loved person. I guess there are other people out there who love him just as much as I did. I'm going to read the poem, Remember Me. My glasses. To the living, I am gone. To the sorrowful, I will never return. To the angry, I was cheated. But to the happy, I am at peace. To the faithful, I have never left. I cannot speak, but I can listen. I cannot be seen, but I definitely can be heard. So as you stand upon a shore gazing at a beautiful sea, as you look upon a flower and admire its simplicity, remember me. Remember me in your hearts, your thoughts, your memories of the times that we loved, the times that we cried, the times that we fought, and the times that we laughed. For if you always think of me, I will never be gone. I always, since the other day, keep referring to the fact that it's quite evident that my brother did his part. This man made everyone feel welcome. He had a no judgment zone, no judgment. Even if he knew that there was something not right about you, no judgment zone. He welcomed you with open arms. There were times when I was mad at him, and he would come and he would just embrace me. I would want to pull away from him, and he wouldn't let me go. And I know that he did that with everybody else. So remember him, because I'm guaranteeing you he will always be there. I just buried his father a couple of years ago. And I'm also going to thank you for participating in raising him. You raised a good man. I know it was hard, a whole lot of trials and errors, and but you did a good job. His beautiful kids are here. Oh my God. I have 4 more kids alongside mine. And his sisters and brothers also did a good part by being there to support him. So just remember my brother, please. Always remember him.
I'd like to call up Cameron Simmons, one of Beresford's sons, to read the obituary.
Beresford Barrington Simmons Jr., born in Kingston, Jamaica on September 12, 1968, passed away unexpectedly the morning of November 8, 2023. In his childhood home, Beres grew up in Brooklyn, New York, but through his love of travels and building community, he created a special connection to Pasadena, California, Hartford, Connecticut, and Snellville, Georgia. Naturally charismatic with a gift for inspiring others, Beres was known as the community OG. You could talk to, chop it up with, and brainstorm with whenever you needed. Beres made it a point to be available to those he loved and showed up for his people. No matter when they called, Beres was a doting father to Kayla, Cameron, Elijah, Alyssa, and Beresford III, who preceded him. At the time of his passing, Beres was a beloved member of the New York City school system. He had an entrepreneurial spirit and dabbled in many business ventures. Beres' biggest joy was being a father and a mentor. In addition to his childhood, Beres truly loved his father, Beresford Barrington Simmons Sr., deceased. Mother Rose Barnaby Jones, stepfather Cornell Jones, his sister Doreen, Suela, and Kuvana, his brothers Daniel, Khalid, Marcus, and Malcolm. He is survived by many close family members, which includes his aunts and uncles, nieces and nephews, grandnieces and grandnephews, and a host of cousins, extended family members, and close friends, both near and far, who were like brothers and sisters growing up. Beres held a special place in his heart for many, including Kimberly, Kwame, Ebony, Jeremiah, Courtney, and Patricia. May he rest in eternal power and peace. And then there's a passage from the Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness. For his name's sake, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will never fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all of the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Thank you.
I would like to call upon Daniel Jones and Doreen Reyes to read the eulogy. Thank you.
As we stand here today, I'm still just, I guess, in denial, like everybody else here, that Veris is gone. It's like, I'm in my head, I know he's not here and he's the person there, but it's just not connecting. So I know, like many of you, please feel your grief and know that it's part of the process that we're all going through. We're all just missing him, all missing him. I'm going to start. It says, for many years, we hear about the importance of the dash between a person's date of birth and the date of their last day earthside. Today, we will spend some time talking about the dash in my brother, Beresford Barrington Simmons Jr.'s life. Beres was born in Kingston, Jamaica on the morning of September 12, 1968. His birth was extra special because his grandmother, Mavis Wilkes Wright, delivered him. In June of 1975, at 6.5 years old, Beres left Kingston for Brooklyn, New York. On his arrival, Beres went to different stores on Rutland Road looking for a job. He was always on the grind.
6.5.
Some of the retail establishment encouraged his spirit and gave him opportunities here and there. Beres was known in school for being an avid learner. He won awards for writing poetry and sang in what was known as the Glee Club. Music had always been one of his biggest loves. He also loved comics, both Marvel and DC, Riddick, wrestling, when it was WWF. Beres also is a very kind and caring individual who would literally give people his last dollar. He always said that as long as he had food in his house, which he would give away too if you needed it, he would be fine. Throughout his life, Beres traveled, shared his humor and energy with people in California, Georgia, and Connecticut. Yet he always made his way back home to Brooklyn. Beres lived a very full life, and with that came some struggles. He used his experiences to connect with the younger generation with the hopes of helping them stay on the right path. He was an inspiration to older ones too. His impact on the community saw no bounds, and he was locally known, I was told, as the mayor of Avenue D. In the more recent years, Beres planned on starting many businesses. He went back to school and all the while prioritized his family. His children, mother, sibling, nieces, and nephews were equally as important as his daily cup of coffee, black with 4 sugars.
How you doing? How you doing? I'm Daniel. It's not an easy day for any of us here. It's not gonna be easy for me to do this, but. Siblings growing up in the same house, you know, we all have stories to share. Basically, my sister Kiwana talks about when Beres, you know, took her to the top of a mountain when he was teaching her to drive. They were on top of a mountain in Cali, and he told her, hey, you know what? Let's see what happens. She told him, hey, we might not be good. This might not be a good idea, but, you know, he was all in. That's the kind of maniac he was sometimes. Doreen tells about when, you know, they stole my mom's car in the middle of the night and parked it 2 blocks down. And she woke up in the morning and she was you know, searching around for the car, and they'd be giggling that she couldn't find it. He was something else. Yeah, it's a little funny. It's a little funny. I could tell you stories of, you know, me being a youngster, you know, shy and scared of girls, and how my brother would slap me in the back of the head and tell me, yo, come on, get it together. You know? I can tell you how he took me the first time in the car. I was scared to death, and this jackass had me driving around Avenue D, no seatbelt, in mom's old blue Oldsmobile. You remember that car?
And the window, you have to hold it.
I remember when I was messing up in school and he, you know, shook me up a little bit and told me to get my shit together. Mm-hmm. Make me get my grades on point. You know, average big brother stuff. You know, keep you in line. That's who he was. And I'm sure he does that with, you know, half of his students here. Because if he didn't, I wouldn't expect you to be here. Sure, that's why you're here, because he kept you in line. He kept you on the straight path. He's helped you along the way. That's who he was. A jokester, a prankster, but he was a role model at the same time. Suella, remember you told us a story about when he came over there to Queens and he had you in the house and he wouldn't let you go outside until you made him a sandwich. And your revenge was to what? Put hot sauce on that. He didn't even get mad. He just, you know, he was proud of his sister for coming up with something clever like that. Yeah. At the end of the day, you know, Harris meant so much to all of us. Mm-hmm. He's going to truly be missed. I'm sure many of you guys here have, you know, stories you'd like to share about Harris and the nonsense or whatever he did, the funny story that he tricked you into something, or, you know, how he helped you along the way at some point. In a moment, don't worry, we'll let you up here.
So today, you have all shown up to offer your support to the family. Please continue to offer your support and call and check up on them in the days, months, and years to come. Check up on each other as well. Don't have moments like this be the only time you connect. I want to remind you all that life is short. Please spend time with those you love. Do the things that excite you. Forgive freely. Make sure your dash is as fulfilling as you can make it. And to you, Beresford Barrington Simmons Jr., may you rest in eternal peace and power. Our King.
Before we open up the mic for the multitude of you who are here today, okay. I'm going to ask that we have 1 minute of silence. Thank you. Thank you. I'm going to now open up the mic for those of you who would like to speak or say a remembrance of Beresford. We just ask that you limit it to no more than 2 minutes. Thank you. You can start lining up over here.
Good morning, everyone. I've cried so much recently, I don't know why. But to fit within this 2 minute timely that I was given here, I have three things to say. One, I have to make an apology. Two, I have a story to tell. And three, I have to read a poem I got from one of my nephews in Jamaica. Oh, what is this? All right. Yeah, I'm going to make an apology to Beres's two youngest kids. I just threatened them earlier today. And they it was so bad that I had one of his youngest daughter apologizing to me. No sweat? Okay. She's apologizing for something she hasn't done as yet. So she has one in the bank already. As a protector, Beres, I went to California a couple of years ago. I was going to Vegas, not California, so I was going to Vegas, and he's like, I have to go look for my daughter. I'm like, your daughter's in California. You're going to drive? He said, no, she moved to Vegas. I'm like, okay, cool. So I came up for my doctor's appointment, and we flew there. Being two guys, you know, we said, okay, we need some stuff in the hotel room. What are we going to do? So we went to this 99-cent store. And Beres being the protector is, we went inside. We had this big truck, because that's all they had when we got there in the morning. And extended 4x4, whatever it is. And we went to the store to pick up some knickknacks, candies, and stuff called Beres snack sweets. And when we came out, the parking lot was full. And there were two guys behind us in a car, and they refused to move their car. So he gets out of the car. I'm like, where are you going? He's like, I'm going to make them move. I'm like, Beres. He said, these guys are old. You know? I said, don't worry about it. I can get out. It's going to take me 10 or 15 minutes to get where we get. So I'm going back and forth. He's out there like, I'm like, what are you doing? I'm looking at them to see if they're really not going to move. I'm saying, I'm good. I finally got out and I came back. He said, you know, if he wasn't here or if you're somebody else, we'd have had beef. I'd be throwing hands all over the place. I'm like, it's good, it's good. So that's what a protector is. He's not going to see you in a little bit of trouble with needs that he's not going to offer his help to you. So, you know, I know, as my sister, my daughter said before, that's how he is. He's going to uplift you. He's going to try to protect you. He's going to try to steer you right. I have a poem here that my nephew from Jamaica sent me. I guess he knew I was hurting. And Kirk, I hope you're watching because I sent you the link. Okay. It's called Wings of Prayer. And reads as this. When you're feeling low and lonely and no one seems to care, reach out to God who loves you and unfold your wings of prayer. Rise above the daily heartaches so common to us all. Just spread your wings and fly away before the teardrops fall. Don't let trials and temptations like anchors weigh you down. Reach to God and He loves you and will not let you down. You can rise above your problems. You can soar almost anywhere. Just put your faith in action and unfold your wings of prayer. Amen. Thanks, Kirk and Beres. I miss you, my boy. I don't know what to say, man. I have asked God, I pray that God will continue to bless you as you sleep, continue to cover you with His mercies, put you at the foot of His throne, continue to hold your kids in eternal grace and protection. We love you, God. And I hope everyone here will reach out to the Lord. He is your Savior and your direction. If you step off and make a mistake, we're all humans, and we're all going to make mistakes. All we need to do is just step back on the treadmill and keep going again. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. It's my little remembrance of Barry. Let me just start off by saying, hey, Barry's. And in his response, he would say, he'd respond back at me and say, hey, Chevy Mac. And I say, what's up? I would say, what's up? And then I would ask him, is everything okay? He would respond and say, everything good? With a big, broad smile on his face. And that will surely, I'm nervous. With a big, broad smile on his face, and that will surely be missed and cherished. You were such a good friend to me and my family ever since we moved on the block. You have a pure heart with good intentions. I could always rely on you. I could always rely on you with whatever I call upon you with. You'll always say, Chevy, I got you. He surely did. On that day when I came in from work and saw the police parking outside the gate, I never imagined that you were no longer here with us. When I called your phone and it went straight to voicemail, my heart suddenly dropped with sorrow and pain. Hearing that my dear friend was on his way to the Lord and Savior, rest well, Barry's. As you embark on this journey to heaven, may your soul rest in peace. You will be missed.
Dallas was the big brother we never wanted
or asked for.
So we live directly across the street.
But growing up,
we were. The houses were connected, even though we were across the street.
We were back and forth across Avenue D, running back and forth. Our house was like a swing, and so was Rose. But I'm here to say, on behalf of my mom, because of course she isn't here, that was his second, maybe third mom. It was always Miss Padmore, Ma, what are you doing? Ma, come outside. You need sun. Ma. And Rose was answering because it was either
they didn't know
that Ma
or the
other
to.
Mom.
Yeah.
Couldn't distinguish. And we don't have that Ma anymore. So on behalf of Mom, she's here, but she isn't here physically. That was her boy. And she's hurting just as much as most of us are today. On behalf of the Simmons family, on behalf of our family to the Simmons family and the Jones family, we love you guys. We are here. We'll always be here. We used to joke all the time if someone didn't know who I was and he was introducing me, that's little sis. I used to change her Pampers. Okay, Barris, everyone need to know that you changed my Pampers, but okay, you changed my Pampers. That's how close we were. And unfortunately, we're here saying, see you later. I remember when my father passed away, it was not the easiest thing for him. He made empty threats to my husband back there. You better take care of her. If you don't take care of her, it's me and you.
He was, right? You're right.
It may not have necessarily been the empty threats, but they were two peas in a pot, and he meant it. He meant it. So to you guys, we love you guys. We're here for you. And
I just have my story. So Barris is the one who taught me how to ride a bike, because Kawana used to leave me all the time and go to Canarsie Pier, and I wanted to go too. So, why don't you go? I said, because I can't ride the bike. And he was like, come on, let's go. So my story is the driveway story.
Get on the bike, Tasha. Drive down the driveway. I got you. Okay. Tasha gets on the bike. I'm going 100 miles an hour. Come on, I got you. The bike's this way. I'm that way. My hand got cut up. My skin is hanging out. Don't worry, don't worry. Oh God, come across the street. Gotta clean you up before your mother get home. She's gonna kill me. And I'm like, the skin is coming. I'm like, Barris, we're gonna die. But all to say is, thanks to him, we rode bikes every summer. We went crabbing. And he also taught me how to roller skate, but that's a whole nother story. But I'm gonna miss him. I'm gonna miss my parking wars. In the morning, he told me, get up and go to work. You're messing up the parking. Go, go.
The loud music.
The loud music when he comes home at night. That's how I know he's home. Mm-hmm. And I felt safe because, okay, he made it home. I can go to sleep now. So he's passed 2 weeks, no music. And it's hard. Love you guys. Did you?
Nobody wanted to hear me speak, but I'm gonna.
Okay.
Stay
up there.
Stay there.
Good morning, everyone. Today is a very hard day for me, but I'm here to pay my last respect to a dear nephew. He was such a special person. When I had the task of taking care of my mother, of his grandmother rather, he and his children were there every step of the way. In fact, even after she passed, he was still willing and able to contribute where possible. Barris will be missed forever. Sleep in peace. May light perpetually shine upon you.
Okay, since I'm the rugrat, I'm younger than her. I'm younger than her, so since I'm that, I have to be second as usual. Anyway, Barris, my oldest, you know, as a young girl, my mouth is big enough. They can hear me. Don't you all hear me in the back without the mic? Barris always tell me every morning I wake him up at about 5:30, 5:45, 6:00. And he always get mad at me and lay back. And I still have to get up and wake him up. And I was like a mischievous person, still is, I think. And we used to get in fight every day. Going to school, we would argue. Come back from school, we'd argue. It doesn't matter what I do, me and Barris is arguing. I made sure he has his dinner when he come home. He was like a spoiled child. Maybe because he was the first, and he'll always be my first. His father at that time was, I won't go into that conversation, but he was always there no matter what I do or what I want. But he was one of those kids that always take my money and give it to people. You're laughing. I'm dead serious. Each morning before he goes to school, no matter how he work at the laundromat and get paid, he never have money. He's always, Ma, you got some money can give me. And now that I have a $10, a $50, he take my $50. When he come back, he don't have any. So he's always giving away, giving. And I'm glad because that's how my grandmother and my mother taught us, and we taught our children that way. But I'm sorry I taught him that way because he always taking my money. But anyway, I'm glad I had him, and I'm glad he survives to take care of me till this point. And I hope to God he rests in peace, even though that night he brought me a chicken sandwich from, what's that place? Popeyes. I still didn't eat it. It's in the fridge still. What?
You ready to go? Well, you know,
eat. No, I'm not eating. It came home about 12 o'clock and brought me a chicken sandwich and brought himself some chicken. But I didn't eat it. I was too sleepy, so I didn't eat it. And it's in the fridge, so I got to dump it now. But thank you, everyone, for listening to my half, whatever story it is. It's not all, but it's a little bit of knowing what type of person he was. And I will miss him because I miss my cup of coffee.
Hi, everyone. My name is Amber, and Ferris is my uncle. And I grew up on Avenue D, but I lived in California for a long time, about 9 years. And one year, I'm an anxious girly, I came home and said, I think I need to leave. I think I need to come back. I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know why I'm still there. And I miss my family. Oh, no. And he told me I had to stay. I don't think I've told any of you this before. He told me I had to stay, that I wasn't done exploring, that I had to find Kayla, which I'm so sorry I never did. And that there was more for me to do, that I couldn't come back until I was done. And he was worried that if I came back home too soon, I wouldn't be done growing. He was just so concerned with how much I had to grow and learn. And so I stayed. I found a new job, I found new friends, I was different. And I've never said thank you for the fact that he pushed me when I was so uncomfortable, when I didn't know what I wanted to do, when I just felt like I needed to come back to what was safe. And if there's one thing that I'm sure a lot of you in this room have felt, it's that Ferris pushed you. He made you uncomfortable, in good and weird ways. But ultimately, he just wanted everyone to grow. He had so much to teach. He had so much he had learned. He loved California so much. It was like this magical land. I kept thinking, where the fuck is Pasadena? Isn't that great? And I'm going to LA next week, and I want to stop by Pasadena. So tell me where to go and see all of Ferris' things. Thanks, Ebony. Okay,
bye-bye. Good morning, everyone. I am Nordia Roy. I'm a teacher at Dr. Susan McKinney Secondary School of the Arts. I think it was approximately 5 years ago, I could be a year off somewhere, that I called him Mr. Barris, that he joined our staff there. And since then, we have worked closely together. So everybody, but I want to speak of the students, really, who were so devastated and when they heard about his passing. And one of our students had made a little memorial in one of the hallways and put his coffee cup there, and, you know, something so people could leave, you know, what a message or so. And so I wrote this as a tribute to him. I understand. At some time, the news of death we will hear. Yet, this unwelcome event never happens without a tear. After hearing that you passed, it seemed the world around me stopped. And very deep into my wealth of memories, I tapped. You weren't just a co-worker, you were a friend and our student's strong defender. I can still remember your strong voice and robust laughter. The students felt your care and love when they invaded your space. But now, with deep emotions, we must face the fragility of the human race. Then you were a son, a father, a brother, and to others, a friend, humble and true. The loss that those who love you feel, no one will ever have a clue. I know you cared for your family, students and co-workers in the best way you could. If their tears could bring you back, I know they would. Forever I will be grateful that you came our way. May the angels in heaven guide you on your journey, I pray. Walk good, Mr. Barris.
Good morning, everybody. My name is LaVon, and I've known Mr. B since I was in like fifth grade. I've lived on 46th and Avenue my whole life. I remember when I first came to the school, he was like, "What are you doing here?" I said, "I go to school here. What are you doing here?" He said, "You better not disappoint me because I'm going to be there when you graduate 12th grade." And I remember like a year ago, I used to be getting into a lot of trouble. He pulled me into class. He put me by my ear and said, "LaVon, if you fuck up and not graduate, I'm going to fuck you up." He said, "You know, I got permission from your daddy. I'm going to fuck you up and I'm not going to care." And I just want to say, B, I'm doing this for you, son. I'm doing this for you. I'm graduating with honors for you. It's everything. You know I love you, right? You know it's just for everything. Everybody, you know I love you, right? You know you're my son. You know you're my son. You will forever be in my heartbeat. I love you so much. Thank y'all for having me.
My name is Kamek. I'm one of Mr. Simmons' students. Simmons wasn't just like a friend to me. Simmons was more of a father figure in the school. You know, all of his students were here to me, all the ones that he loved. Simmons loved everybody. Simmons loved everybody, even if they didn't love him back. Every morning I get up, see Simmons. Simmons always want to joke on my way early in the morning. Always saying, always calling me Meeks. Simmons, I love you, man. And there's nothing else I could ever bring you back. If I could bring you back, I would. Mama, I love you. I love all the family. I love all my friends. Everybody that's here. I give my praise to the family. All right, y'all.
My name is Kaya Ryan, and I was one of Mississippi students. And he really meant a lot to me and my brother. He's not here today, but he really sends praise to your family. And he helped us through a lot. Like, we've been through a lot, and he was someone we could confide and just vent. For a short period of time, you used to let me call me Grandpa. And like we always talk it, and I was always asking, why are you drinking that coffee? It's so bitter. And so when I found out he wasn't here no more, like my whole world fell apart. Because he was really important to me. And Simmons, I want you to know that I'm going to graduate and I'm going to become that attorney you wanted me to become. And I just made honor roll. And I just want you to know that I did all of this for you.
Hi, my name is Kalia. To be honest, when I first got to Susan McKinney, still to this day, I couldn't tell you who Mr. Mayor was in the building. He was the principal to everything to me, my father, everything. Anything I ever had to vent about, he always answered the phone. I never called Mr. Simmons, Mr. Simmons. I called him Mr. Man. to this day, everything saved on my phone is Mr. Man. So, Mr. Man always told me, make sure you graduate. Don't worry about nothing else. Just make sure you graduate and go to college. That was one of the last things we spoke about. He told me to promise him that I was gonna graduate. I love him more than words I can even explain, man. That's Mr. B, y'all. That's all I can really say. I love y'all, to the family, the mom, everybody.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Cheryl Toussaint. I am the meet director of an event called the Colgate Women's Games. It's a Brooklyn program, and it's been in existence for nearly 50 years, 48 years this year. I wasn't always meet director, but I've had that responsibility for the last 10 years or so. Ed Wright, Rudolph Wright, who are members of our staff, came to me and said, I have a young man who would like to work with you. And because this program is a program about empowering young girls to achieve their personal best in sport and in school, give scholarships, and they're young girls. And it's very important that we make sure that they come in the door, they're safe when they're there, and that they leave, and they're as good or better than when they came in. These are somebody else's children. Vera stepped through the door, and I looked at him. I didn't really know what his strengths were. So we put him in a spot where he was sort of like a maintenance person in the beginning. And he did that for a while, and he said, you know what? Whatever you need me to do, I'm here. Whatever you need me to do, just put me there. But I could see from how he worked with all of our staff and how he related to me that he had a gift of compassion. And he also was a protector. And that's what I wanted to make sure. We put him in the best spot where he could do his best and serve us best. So we put him in that spot. And I got to tell you, there's never been a day that we've had the event when Barris was around where our team didn't feel more secure. I never worried about the protection of the girls in the space that we were in because I knew Barris was on point. He would come over and say, call me Cheryl. He said, Cheryl, you know, this is going on over here or this is going on over there. What do you want me to do? We work with another gentleman named Sean. Our team is back there. If y'all would just wave, because all of them came out for Barris because he wasn't with us a long time, but for the time that he was with us, he made a heck of an impact, and we are going to miss him. So thank you for sharing him with us.
Good morning. I'm also a member of Colby Women Games. I know Stevie and how Eddie for a long, very long time. When they introduced me to Barris, it was like adopted brother already. When Barris passed away, Stevie said, "Oh, Doc, Barris gone." I said, "What are you talking? I'm in my bed." "So what are you talking about?" I said, "No, man, you're kidding." He said, "Yes, Barris gone." I said, "Barris? I thought I was a singer." He said, "No, my nephew gone." I said, "Oh boy." But Barris and I goes, for the short time I was at Colgate, was a guiding for me and for the Colgate woman there. He comes and he said, "Hey, you dress up like me, you have on white sneakers, black pants, top on." I said, "I want to be like you. But now you go and I gotta follow your pattern." And mommy, my sympathy, my condolence to everyone in the family. And I would always be there for you guys to know that. And for my two brothers them in the back there. And let me see. Cherry also. So to all the family, God bless you all. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Susie. I am the cousin, but I'm speaking for two today, for myself and from his family in England. Well, the family knows, but we have a lot of family in England and no one was able to make it. So they asked me to tell you guys that they're sending their condolences, their love, and their strength. And then his cousin, Candace, she said, for me to tell you, she said, to my beautiful cousin, Barris, like everyone, I got my stories to tell. Always copying my accent and asking me to say London. Then you and Daniel would laugh for hours. However, I like to say thank you for making me the person I am now. Without you and Daniel, I would not be the strong person I am now. Rest in peace. Candace. Excuse me, I don't know why I'm nervous. I like to talk, but I'm nervous today. And Uncle Cornell, he spoke about Barris being a protector. Yo, I think that runs in our bloodline. The men in our family are always, they always have us. I haven't spoken to Barris, I think, since your grandma passed. And before that, it was some years before. But anytime we link up, it's like the day never passed. He talked crap. He talked strong. He was talking about Rose, Auntie Rose. He was saying how... I don't care what happens. Nobody know, do not know. My aunt to my mama, you know, that's how he is. He was always like that. That's in his blood, you know, so represent for the bloodline. And I remember when we were young, y'all don't remember this. We used to be young. When we was young, I used to spend the night at the house. And we would have to come in early. He would kick me, Kavana, and Doreen in the house. And I'm like, well, why we got to come in so early? Y'all still outside? He said, well, it's getting dark. It's getting dark and you girls, y'all gotta stay in. Only the men can stay out. Y'all remember that? And I'm like, but it's not even dark yet. The light didn't even go down. So he was like that with us when we was young and still older. 6 o'clock and it was still sunlight. And the one thing I wanted to say, I wanted to follow up on what Doreen said about the dashes. So the dashes between the years we born and the years and year that we passed, we transitioned. So when Barris was born, he was born, right? Then the dash was the time that he had his experience on this earth. He obviously affected so many people. He shared his love with so many people. And you guys have so much experiences with him to the time that he passed. But the point I wanted to make is that remember that dash, as Doreen said. That was the experience. So when you go throughout life, think about your dash. He gave his love, right? He came on this earth and he gave his love. That was his purpose on this world. So now that he's passed, think about your dash. What will you do with your dash? Rest in paradise, my cousin.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Greg, and that is my uncle laying next to me. As my mother stated, it's kind of hard to connect the person here to, you know, everything that's going on. But what I do want to say is that I'm so glad that the last couple of people, you know, including my grandfather, spoke about the protection aspect of a parent. I mean, when you talk about the ultimate protector, that is that man right here, right? Growing up throughout my life, we spent a lot of time on Avenue D. And my mother, you know, while Uncle Barris was in California, she always told me, you know, I got another brother in California. You just never met him. You never met him. And I'm like, okay. And it wasn't until I was about maybe 11, 12, somewhere around that range, where he came back over to the East Coast. And I mean, from that day, it was just, I just fell in love with this man. And he's been just by my side ever since. One of the biggest things, obviously, was his kids, man. I mean, I don't think, and as it should be, I mean, there was nobody, no other people more important than his kids. Anytime I went to the West Coast, he would always make sure, try to link up with everybody. I'm like, all right, I'll try. I'll see what's going on. I mean, it never came to fruition, but I'm glad that you guys are here. I'm glad to meet you guys in person. Man, it's just crazy that he's laying here and I'm here giving this speech today. Uncle Barris, I love you. I'll see you again. And this is not the end, man. This guy was one of my biggest male influences in my life. Him, his brother Uncle D, were always there for me. So I will love him for that. Uncle D, I love you for that. And everybody here, I'm just so glad everybody was able to come out and share their love with my uncle, man. Uncle Barris, I love you. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. My name is Dree, and this is Eric. And I just had to come up here and pay respects to the guy, like everyone is saying, I'm a piggyback on. And his testimony that he is who he is and have so much love for everybody and everybody have so much love for him. If you just take a look around and you see how much people in here showing him so much love, it's just giving it right back. When I met him, I haven't known him for so long, but 6 years is long enough. And when I first met him, the vibe was positive. And I turned to this man here and I'm like, you know, you might want to take a page out of his book.
maybe
you know, a lot of people might want to take a page out of his book. And I had to come up here and pay my respects because every time I saw him, he made sure he paid respect to me. He made sure he came and said, hello, how you doing? Take this man home. You know, and Barris was a good person. I'm a piggyback on everybody. Barris was a good person. The day that we passed by the house and I seen ambulance outside, I said, babe, is that Barris' house? The ambulance is over there? Then the next minute, we just brushed it off. He was like, nah. And then he was like, we came back, ambulance gone, police is sitting in front of the house. I was like, babe, you know when the police is sitting in front of the house, that means somebody's gone. You better call Mama Rose and see if it's her, see if it's Barris is good. And sadly, it was B. And my heart felt heavy. Never hung out with this man, but just the encounters with him was a good one. Good enough that he touched me in a positive way. And I had to come and pay respects to Barris. Barris, I'm grateful for the time that I've known you, and I hope you rest in peace, my brother. Much love. Mama Rose, my condolences. Family.
Mama Rose, I said, you know, I was messing with you last night anyway. I told you, even with the blessings, because you know me and Barris go back from skateboard and skelly. And we had our times, you know. Ups and downs, getting in trouble and everything. The embarrassment of getting beaten, out of coming out of school, getting beaten and everything. Those are the growing up, the growing pains, as they say. This is my bro. And as I said before, you gained another son. I told you, Daniel, you gained a brother. And I told you also, you got another dad. That's what it is. Love you guys.
How y'all doing? I'm trying to get this to where I'm breaking down. I used to go to Susan McKinney to pick up my daughter. She used to be getting in a lot of trouble, fighting. And he used to be like, D, I got her. He used to call me on the phone. Be like, yo, your daughter's going crazy. But I got it all. Took it to the room and calmed her down. I got a bunch of stories with him, but mostly the week before he passed, I was taking my daughter to therapy. And he was in his car eating. I'm like, what's good? He's like, what's good? Me, him, and Mr. Lynn, another guy I'd like to thank for helping my daughter get through school. We're supposed to be having a little lunch for him. Me and Mr. Lynn still gonna have it in his honor. But my dude, man, you know, I'm gonna miss you, bro.
Hi, I'm Edgar. Mr. Lynn, I worked with Ferris the last 4 years at Susan S. McKinney. He started out as a paraprofessional for an inclusion program that we had at District 75, with District 75 at McKinney. And I knew really like the second day I met him that he was someone who I wanted to be on our team at McKinney. You could tell by the smile on his face. You could tell by looking into his eyes that he was real and he was genuine. We, I think, obviously born into different worlds. I want to thank the powers that brought us together. We would say that we are brothers from another mother. We both come to school with a white t-shirt and jeans on. And except he'd never get out of those. But he would come into my office in the morning when I would change and tell me about his day, what happened to the laundromat night before. Most times we'd laugh, sometimes we'd cry. He was a man of feelings, too. And I think it's so important that those sitting here know that Mama Rose, he loved you so much. He talked about his kids all the time. He was so proud of your siblings, our conversations. And it's been a blessing and a privilege to have known their sins. And I know he lives on. He's going to live on in me. I know that he will live on in all of us here and beyond these walls. So thank you. Thank you, parents.
Hi, I'm Samantha. I'm another one of Ferris's nieces. I was a pretty miserable child. I'm also a miserable adult, so nothing's really changed. But Uncle Ferris was always he was such a jokester. And I remember seeing him all the time and being like, why are you so jolly? Like, there's nothing to be so jolly about. And I remember one time in front of his apartment in Hartford, me, my mother, and my brother all devised this plan to put a whoopee cushion on his car seat. And so we put it down, we put a towel over it, and then he gets in the car being all loud, yo, 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 what's going on? He gets in and the whoopee cushion went off and he just bursted out laughing. He just had no shame or nothing. And I feel like that was one of the best laughs that I've had, even as a child. So Uncle Bears, I promise I'll try to stop being as miserable. And I'll take a note out of your book and just laugh at even the smallest thing.
Hi, everybody. I'm Crystal. I am another niece. And as all of you can tell today, that we are very, very tight-knit family. We're all super close. We all, every last one of us in some way, shape, or form, ran through that house in Avenue D. So piggybacking on what my sister said and my brother when he came up earlier, when my uncle came back to the East Coast, I was probably like 14 in high school. And like my brother said, my mom used to talk about this brother that she had out in Cali. And, you know, I heard all these stories. He was a boxer. He was this, you know, he was that. He used to run through these streets. And I used to be in high school, freshman year of high school, just like, I got this uncle. Like, don't come to me. Don't come at me. I got this uncle and he's coming. I used to tell everybody because as everybody has said, this man was our protector. Like he had us, he had my back with everything. When I finally did get to meet him, it was just, we were just connected, like soul connected. We've always been so close. I used to just pick up the phone and call him, just have conversations. He gave me phrases like living life raw when he was just out here just living and head down doing his work, doing what he had to do. He was just fun and funny. Some other memories I have are like all of us packing in my mom's little two-door Acura. It was like six of us. I don't know if Elijah remembers. I know Ebony remembers. We used to be packed in that car like seven deep in this little two-door Acura. So, and Uncle Bear sitting in the front, complaining the whole time, but cracking up. So it's just stuff like that. Like he always made a situation funny. No matter what it was just always funny. He would just crack up about it, tell a joke, whatever, and just lighten the mood every time. So, thank everybody for being here. Thank you for celebrating him with us. And with that, that's it for me.
Yes, Rose. I've been Rose's neighbor for 40 years. And I remember in my difficult time, family adopted me. My name is Matthews. Her name is Matthews. Barris was special, okay? He was a son to me, a brother to my daughter, and I want to thank him. And the reason I'm up here, because I want to tell his students, I'm a retired teacher, and his mom and I used to go pick him up in the car after school, and he used to vet. Because he loved you guys so much, it bothered him when you weren't doing your best. And I just want to let you know that no matter what happens in life, Barris is an example that you can achieve. Because I always told him how proud I was of him, because he's come a long way. And how important it is for family to be there, because Rose, oh my God, I take strength from the love that she has for her children. And how that love encourages her and helps them in life. I didn't know Barris was so supportive to my daughter until she told me. But he will question every guy he sees over. Where are you going? Okay, big brother. And if Marion was in home and I was sick, and I would say, Barris, I don't feel good. Can you go to the store and get me some soup? And he would go and he would get it for me. Rose and I are like sisters. This is the best type of sisters, because when that blood, she adopted me, when this one here was like a month old. Thank you, Willie, also.
Okay, so I just want you kids to know he truly loved you. And he just wanted to see you guys do your best. And he's an example that no matter what difficulties you have in life, you can achieve.
I said I wasn't going to speak. I said if I cry, somebody better punch me in my chest. And Barris would be the one to do it because I hate to do it. But I will say this. It does feel weird not having the mayor of Avenue D. You know what it feels? It feels quiet. Nobody's whistling at 7:30. No one's going, you good. I'm like, yeah, I'm good. I love you. I show them off. I love you. I love you. Bye. Bye, Barris. Bye. But especially after the pandemic was set outside on WeTalk, and he was definitely like an older brother figure. And I'm an only child. I'm a little naive. He would watch me and be like, I see you. And he'd preach. He'd make you uncomfortable because he wouldn't want you to grow. And again, to his students, he would sit there and talk about his students. I worked at a high school. Do your kids do this, this, that, and the third? Yeah, they do. And he always said if he could make a difference to one student, it didn't matter. And baby, it's more than one. And he sees you and he appreciates you.
Hi everyone, I'm Kim. I used to argue with Barris all the time. Barris, you cannot save the world. But listen to everybody, I guess you could. He was a protector. I have a story to share with you guys. We were together as kids. I was like 17, 16, the Roy Rogers. And I came to work. I had a bad experience. Two guys like harassed me on the train. And I was scared. So that night, we closed and we had like a big rat problem at Roy Rogers. So we stayed extra late. So at the end, it was like maybe 2:30 in the morning. And Barris like, I'm going to take you home. I live in Far Rockaway. The last stop in Far Rockaway. And B sat with me on the train all the way to Far Rockaway. To go back to Brooklyn. I think he had the car rolls to come pick him up. I miss you. I should have said this first. Let's thank God for the time he gave Barris to be with us. You truly will be missed. Thank you.
My name is Asha. I go to McKinney. Mr. Simmons is what I call him. Sorry. I met Simmons in 8th grade. Ever since then, he made sure to build bonds with every student in the school. He made sure everybody was good, that everybody, you know, felt safe always. There would be times where I would say the most times I was around Simmons was when, you know, I'd be in the bathroom and tell him to get out the bathroom right now before I get in trouble. The last conversation we had was about him not wanting me to get in trouble. By being somewhere in school that I wasn't supposed to be, in class. But even though Simmons was hard on, you know, some people because he wanted them to do better, yeah, I already know what he used to say after the lecture. I love you. I still love you. When he passed, it was unbelievable to me. Like, I couldn't sit there. No, he didn't. It's no way. And I feel like I was more so, you know, worried about the comfort of others, the people that was closer to him than I was, that I didn't get to do with my own grief. That day, I told the basketball players that we found out they had a game. And I was like, y'all better do this for Simmons. Y'all better work for Simmons. And for any McKinney student, any student, period,
Everything that you do moving forward this day, you do it for Simmons. Simmons might not have one that you give up, and I get it. It's hard to, like, you know, go through this, process it. People don't know how to grieve the right way. It's okay, everyone has a different, you know, way of grieving. But the one thing that you don't do is stop. Don't stop. Ever. You keep moving forward. You keep going, because that's what Simmons would have wanted. He's with our Heavenly Father. He's watching over us. We miss you. We love you. We love you so much.
Good morning, everybody. I remember this guy for years. When he took me under his wing and started liking me as a friend. And ever since then, he's always been my friend. I never knew this happened until I passed by. And then one of the guys I know outside told me, he said, James, he's in there. What are you in there for? I thought it was somebody else because I work here. So I said, he didn't go see him. He showed me. I said, you kidding? I'm the last to know of everything. I'm going to miss him. Because he always treated me good, kind. He never let nobody mess with me up and down here. He always looked out for me. And I see how he treat other people. And always with respect. When he used to come by in his SUV, James, where you got to go? Come on, I take you. I said, you can't drive that far. Come on, man, come on. And I went. And he made sure I got back home. Listen, I knew, like I said, I knew this guy for years. And nobody gonna know, if you don't know him, don't quote him. Because just like the young lady said, he's a beautiful person. In his heart and in his soul. We all make mistakes. We all make errors. But it's up to us to correct them. And that's what he did with his life. That's why he was able to be nice with me. I'm going to miss him. Because, I never knew. Because I walked down the block. My boss called me early this morning. He said, James, you have to do the main thing, no problem. Okay, no problem. I never knew it was him. Until the guy outside told me. I'm the last to know of everything. Until I go act. But then again, you can't ask too many questions about nobody. Because some things is none of your business. You know, nobody called me. I know his moms and everybody. But I never knew. And like I said, I'm going to miss him, man. Because he was very nice. That's my man there. That's my man. If he see me walking down the block, James, come here. How you doing? You all right? Yeah, I'm good. Nobody's messing with you right now. Everything is great. But thank you guys for listening to me. And thank you for all of your time. There's like a bunch of my friends is over there on the corner. They're all good. They all know me like a book. And they know I'm okay. I don't bother nobody. I don't mess with nobody. But when this happened, I never knew. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Good day to everyone. Well, my name is Howard Wright. I'm one of Barris's uncle. Tough for me. From the day Barris was born, I was right there. And my sister gave birth, I was here with my mom, right there. Barris was, he was like my little sidekick. One of those pictures coming up there with little Barris, I'm sitting right beside him, listening. Barris, there's strong love I have for Barris. You know, and the morning he passed away, I was on my way to work. I ride a motorcycle. And someone accidentally opened the door on me. I had an accident right there. While I was dealing with the accident, I kept getting calls. I called back. Until a friend called and said, first thing he said, Barris passed away. First thought came to me, he said, Barris Hammond? I said, no, Barris. So you'd never bet. So whoa. Tears came to my eyes immediately. But I was just speaking to Barris that very Saturday. And we were talking about things he went through and all the stuff he went through. And, you know, we had a good talk, I'm type when it comes to my nephews and nieces, I mess with them. We joke around. And as you all know, Barris talks a lot. Barris. But he's fun, you know, and everything that everyone has said about him is 100, you know, and I think about him ever since that, since he passed me, every day I think about him, and some tears come to my eyes because I miss him, just like I'm sure a lot of people do, you know. For students, one thing I'm going to ask for you to do, fulfill your promise to him. Graduate. All right? Make something of yourself. All right? That's one thing you're not believing. Take care of yourself. Make sure you become somebody. All right? For everyone here who loves him, which I'm sure you all do, don't forget it. I've never left Barris. No matter what he's been through, I've always been there for him, and he's always been there for his family. His children, Barris would come to me and tell me, say, hey, I'm glad. But you would tell me a few years back, we would talk a lot, and I'm sure he spoke to a few other of his uncles at times too. And I've not forgot what he said to me a few times. Should anything happen to him, I want to make sure he gives his children, look out for his children. They know I'm always here for them. You know, that's something, one promise I'll keep to him. When his father passed away, he said his father told him to look out for his siblings, and he's been doing that, as they can attest to. Versus, like I said, like everyone said, he's a protector. You know, I love my neighbor. I'm going to miss it. I know it's harder than everybody. Trust me, I wouldn't miss it, man. Thanks, everyone, for showing up and giving your insight on your experiences with him. All right? Thank you, everyone.
Good afternoon, everyone. Mom? And condolences to you and your family. Respect due to Armand Onfu. And from my family to you and to your entire family, our condolences and prayers to you. All that I've heard here is a testament for man who shows his love. Right? And it was unbelievable to me when I heard of his passing. I told my husband, I have to come and show my respect, because I have lived on East 38th Street. East 38th Street crew, I know there are some of you in here, right? Respect to all of us. I know respect to the Avenue D family, right? But I've known him for over 20 years. My daughter's 20, so it's 20 plus years that I have seen him passing on Avenue D. And he always had that respect and always had that love. This year, I hadn't seen him for a while, and that's because he was working all the time. And I stopped, and like someone said, he can talk. I was going to the store, and when I tell you, we were outside on Avenue D in front of the house talking for 2 hours. 2 hour conversation. And in that conversation, what I thought I knew about him and what I learned about him was amazing. What he has shared was his love for all the young people that he worked with. And I tell you, he said he has been through so much in his life that he believes it's important to give back and to do something else. And as, you know, as a minister and as I'm talking, you know, with him, we talked about our faith. And we talked about the fact that the one and only true God knows and sees everything, right? And no matter what we go through, no matter what we experience in this life,
But this life is not easy. It's not easy, especially the fact that this man fights for the children, encourages the children. It is a message for every person, every adult in here. When we think we see kids and they're supposed to be seen and not spoken and not heard from, right? He gave them an opportunity to tell their story. And in telling his story of his testament, of his life, he inspired every single young person in here. That is a message of love. Jesus Christ came in his last year of ministry, right? He came, his message was that he came to save the sick, the lost, right? Those that everybody forgets, even the children, right? And he came for us, them. Those that are lost, do not know where they are, do not know where they're going, don't even know what their purpose is. Jesus Christ came for every single one. So I want you to remember, even as he came, he loved us with all our faults. This man showed love even despite the things that, you know, he experienced with children or whatever, but he loved them. And love is the key. Love is the way, because Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. So for everybody here who knows, have been brought up in their faith, and know who God is, if you know this prayer, please say it with me, because he is the one true and mighty God. So with me, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. But lead us not into temptation, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is God's prayer to every single person. Every single person is born, and every single person must rest in order for the Father to come back. So remember that we're all created, right? We're all created to give God the praise. We're all created to love one another. But please, rather than judge, especially the young ones and those out there who we think are the least of the lost, remember that God loves everyone. Amen?
Amen.
God bless you.
So prior to closing the ceremony, we're going to ask for Beres's four children to come and speak. Kayla, Cameron, Elijah, and Alyssa. The mic is yours.
Elijah, hurry up. Got people waiting on you, brother. Hi, everyone. We talk about your first love. Your hero, your best friend, that was my dad. And I just want to let all of the kids know. We would talk every morning, every other morning on my way to work. And I'd be like, what you doing, old man? What you up to? What's going on? And he would tell me so many stories about y'all being in the bathroom. How he'd have to get y'all out of the bathroom. And I'm like, Dad, they just, you know, they're just looking for something to feel good. They just need an escape right now. You gotta connect with them. Like, you know? I'm like, Dad, you remember that was me. I see myself in so many of you. And this whole experience has inspired me to complete my dreams. And he always told me, whatever you do, don't give up. Finish. Do what you gotta do. If you wanna sing, sing. Don't give up. And he always made sure that he would say, I love you. I love you. Spoke to him the day before he passed.
And I'm so blessed to say that the last thing that he said, guess what? I said, what? I love you. Dad. I love you too, Pop. I got you. And I'm gonna fulfill everything, I promise. And I got my brothers and sisters. I got them. And I got y'all too. Thank you guys for loving my dad the way that you did. Thank you for taking care of him. And thank you for allowing him to love you.
I don't have a lot that I have to say because I feel like right now all I've been doing is trying to absorb, you know, all this knowledge and all this experience that you guys have shared with me because I didn't really get the luxury to, you know, make as many experiences as everybody else did. But I know a few years ago I reached out to my sister. That's actually how I got in contact with my dad. Me and her talked on the phone, I don't know, probably like half a year, maybe a couple months. And then she came out to California out of nowhere and she just asked me, she was like, you want to talk to him? I was like, it was kind of out the blue, but I was like, sure. Like, I mean, why not? And when I tell you, I had never experienced somebody so ecstatic to speak to me for the first time like that. Like as an adult, you don't really get that type of love up front from, for me, what was a new person, but for him, it's like, I've known you your whole life, even if you didn't know it. You feel me? And, you know, it was different for me. It was a little different, but I appreciated every moment of it and every conversation that me and him got to have together. The first thing he would always, or not even the first thing, but the one thing he always used to tell me is, you're good. You're always good. Like, you come from me. You're like me. You're always good. We're always good. That's just in us. And, you know, I keep that in the back of my mind every day. I just always make sure I remember that. And that's all I got to say.
Once again, on behalf of the entire family, Simmons, Jones, you name it, whether you have our last names or not, we are so thankful for you all being here. Thank you for spending your morning and sharing your time in remembrance of a son, a brother, a father, and an uncle. We're going to be closing up the casket now as we all say our goodbyes so we can go to our private ceremony. But please, if you would like to join us for the repast, it will be at 58 Fifth Avenue. Thank you.
Well, when I was younger.